Dames en heren, nadat Erwin ons een beeld heeft geschetst van de kosmos als een grenzeloze oceaan van bewustzijn, waarin continu wezens geboren worden en sterven als wervels in het water, zullen we in deze lezing inzoomen op één wervel, de levenscyclus van het planeetwezen Aarde. Een cyclus waarmee onze eigen groei, ik geloof dat...
Nee, het gaat goed.
Nou, het gaat goed.
Ik moet alleen PowerPoint bedienen.
Oké.
Nou is de start gegeven, dan gaat het onderdrukken.
Now it's really going to start off. Now I'm going to succeed. The life cycle of the planetary being, that's where we're talking about. A cycle with which our own growth as human beings and humanity is closely interwoven. The holy books of the world, religions, provide information about the birth and the life cycle of our planet. But the information is expressed in symbolic language. Think, for instance, of the 7 days of creation in the Bible. To be able to unriddle this symbolism, you need the key thoughts of the universal wisdom. The Theosophia that Erwin just expressed, and that we will apply for our own cosmic home, our planet Earth. A cosmic home that is guided and inspired by a highest consciousness, that in this lecture we will call the planetary being. Every rebirth of a planet also starts in this planetary consciousness. How can we imagine that? In a planetary being that is a very spiritual resting condition, awakens at a certain moment the urge to manifest itself, to express again its slumbering characteristics, and to take on its role within the great cosmos again. You could well compare it with the urge in us or in vegetable beings to grow again in spring. You could also compare it very well with the urge in ourselves that causes our awakening from sleep. Also when we are not held by an alarm clock. It is our own consciousness that makes us wake up. It is our desire to become part of the familiar conditions of the exterior world again, and thus to gain experience.
How does the planetary birth take place? The awoken planetary being makes contact with a center in a more outer cosmic realm. And on this first realm, the planetary being activates a focus that immediately acts as a magnet, exercising a powerful attraction upon many beings that at that moment are still in a condition of spiritual rest. That first cosmic realm is by comparison very spiritual. The birth process always proceeds from the most inner, the most spiritual realm, via a number of intermediate steps to the most material realm for that being. Growth always, ladies and gentlemen, takes place from the inside to the outside, from the spiritual unity to the material diversity. All beings that feel attracted to this new focal point, they start to build at that moment the body of the planet. That gets the shape of a very ethereal globe. Subsequently, the planetary being projects a focal point in the next, slightly more material realm, and thus attracts the beings that belong there. And this process continues step by step until the planet has re-embodied itself completely. The globe Earth, in which we live and gain experience at the moment, is the most material globe of our planet. This means that all beings of the planet are, from the moment of their birth, involved in the building up process of the planet. Also, we humans were from the beginning living building blocks of our planet Earth. The history of the Earth is also our history. It develops together. You can ask, why are we human beings attracted to planet Earth and not, for example, to the planetary beings on Mars or Venus? A planet is a magnificent cooperation of beings, and in nature there's no such a thing as coincidental cooperation. There's everywhere and always the strict law of cause and effect. We participate in the planetary team Earth because we feel attracted to this team. The character of the Earth is in accordance with our own individual character. And we built this individual character ourselves in the past by the choices we made.
It is in fact the matter of free will. By the choices we made ourselves, we were attracted to planet Earth. Because here we find the circumstances in which we can unfold ourselves. In other words, to say it, the frequency of our consciousness matches well with the frequency of the consciousness of the Earth. The pattern of cycles that belong to our consciousness matches well with the pattern of the earthly cycles. So we, and with us many other beings, were attracted to the Earth. Were all these attracted beings equally far advanced in their development? No, on the contrary. The planetary being attracts beings in many stages of development, from the highest gods to the least advanced beings that animate the elements in nature. From the first start, there were also mineral, vegetal, animal, and human beings. In short, beings of all kingdoms. In this illustration, all kingdoms are mentioned. The three superhuman kingdoms, beings that are further ahead than ourselves, the humans, the animals, still in the class before us, the plants, the minerals,
and even more primitive are the elemental kingdoms. Now, every kingdom has an indispensable function in the big organism Earth. Otherwise, the totality would miss an organ. So there is a fundamental underlying interdependency of all beings in relation to all beings. In daily life, we recognize this everywhere. A corporation or organization is only an independently working unit if all tasks are being fulfilled. The technician is as much needed as, for example, the financial expert or the organizer. From the Theosophia derives that every kingdom, from gods to atoms, is indispensable within the planet and fundamentally equal to all others. For instance, planet Earth cannot exist without humanity, which, so to speak, is its thinking organ. How does the inner growth of all these earth beings take place within one life faith of the earth? According to the Theosophia, one life phase of planet Earth takes 4,320,000,000 years, so over 4 billion years. During this, from our perspective, immense cycle, every Earth being can reach relative perfection within its own kingdom. What do we mean by that? Beings that at the birth of the Earth start with the animal phase can, within these 4 billion years, develop all characteristics that belong to a relatively perfect animal consciousness. And beings that start with the human phase, and that was us, at least most of us, are capable of becoming relatively perfect human beings. In this regard, you can see a life period of the Earth as a school year at the cosmical school, in which all beings move to a higher class every year, one kingdom higher, at least if they learn their lessons well. Because every being must, through its own efforts, make use of the chances offered. So, we are all cosmic pilgrims that cycle after cycle whirl upward as on winding stairs, as at urban shows, and expand and deepen our consciousness.
Every cycle is composed of a number of typical phases of growth that we can recognize everywhere. Which are these phases of growth? Essentially, there are two phases, the first half and the second half. In the first half, we unfold our outer nature, our body, while at the same time, our spiritual nature is being enveloped, being enfolded, is descending into matter, as it were. And then, after the middle of the cycle is reached, after the turning point, the second half, the unfolding of our spiritual nature starts, paralleled by the envelopment, the involution of our outer nature, which is being dissolved into the spiritual. We reach again the same ethereal level where we began, but now with a big dose of extra experiences and awakened qualities. In the symbol language of the holy books, these two phases are often described as follows. First, we lose the condition of paradise, the condition of unconscious harmony, so that after many difficulties and peregrinations, we return through our own efforts to paradise, but now independent and of our own choice. In the theosophical literature, these two phases are called the descending arc and the ascending arc. But when we zoom in a little deeper into one cycle, these two phases can be subdivided further. We can divide a cycle in 3 or 4 or 7 or 10 or even 12 phases. Now we choose for a sevenfold division because it is directly recognizable in the exterior nature. One life period of the planetary being consists of 7 developing rounds, each of which lasts hundreds of millions of years. In the first to the fourth development round, materialization takes place. The turning point is in the fourth phase, and from the fourth to the seventh phase, the development of all beings is aimed at the spiritual, at the unfolding of their higher characteristics. All beings spiritualize. Each development round is in its turn divided in 7 smaller cycles that we call the planetary classes. Each lasts several millions of years. So there are 49 7-to-7 planetary classes between rebirth and death of the planet. And that is being shown here. And these planetary classes, again, are divided in 7 smaller cycles, and so forth, and so forth. Cycles within cycles, worlds within worlds. The pattern of the large is being followed in the small, always. Every cycle, small or big, gives the Earth beings the chance to unfold a certain aspect of their conscience, as Erwin said.
In between these seven big six cycling rounds of the planet, there are also 6 sleeping periods. These planetary sleeping periods we can compare very well with our human sleep.
Tijdens zo'n slaapperiode in die uitbol juist hele logische omwentelingen plaats. Test. Dat is mij nu in de hand.
Oké, we try to continue.
Sleeping period.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, imagine many beings of a planet are in a deep phase of rest. Herman said we need those phases of rest. But at that moment, the outer ball is being prepared for the next round of development that is going to happen. And then we see that in the crust of Earth, all kinds of transformations take place that make the planet suitable for the new round of development that will follow. So all the stones are being mixed. An example of a planet in its sleeping period is Mars. Recently, we hear all scientists say that there has been running water on Mars, and that Mars has had a much stronger magnetic field than it has now. With this, they confirm the theosophical teachings unconsciously. If you are wondering how active Mars look like, you only need to have some patience, a couple of million of years perhaps, and then you know. In which round of development are we now? In order to answer this question, we take you through all the 7 rounds of development. And in all the 7 phases, one quality of consciousness is being activated, while at the same time, another quality moves to the background, loses its dominating role. And every time, we compare each round with a phase in a cycle that we can all imagine. That's the cycle that you start when you emigrate to another country. We want to show you that you, if you look behind the external differences, can recognize the same faces of consciousness, but limited in a way, of course. How does an emigration start as an ideal or a wish in your thoughts? It starts as a mental seed. That ideal is the motivating power of all actions that you need to do. And in the same way, the first development round of a planet starts. The most developed beings of the planet awake and form an ideal image. You could say a divine blueprint or pattern within which all cycles can find their own spot. You could say that these highest beings create the conditions in which all less far developed beings can go through their own evolutionary cycles.
Hoe gaat die eerste fase?
Well, how does phase one develop? The planetary beings get out of their condition of unconscious unity and envelop themselves in their very ethereal bodies. From that moment on, they experience the world as a world of contradictions, where high and low exist, big and small, spirit and matter, and so forth. The sense of unity disappears to the background. The consequence is that in phase one, the material aspect develops, and the most inner aspect, the unity aspect, the oneness aspect, dresses in matter, or it envelops itself. In this phase, we, as the emigrant, get off the plane, and we try to arrange a place to live. First of all, we need a home of matter. Our wish to unite ourselves with the new country, get its first concrete material form. In the second development round of the planet, all beings develop their senses, their abilities to sense, and their emotions. During the first round, their consciousness was hardly directed to the outer world, but this strongly increases during the second round. And as they concentrate more on the outer world, with its diversity of forms, their vision of the underlying connections become weaker. Lao Tse said in his book Tao Te Ching, the colors blind the eye, the sounds deafen the ear. What he meant by this was, the more we accredit reality to the observations of our material senses, the less we will see with our spiritual eye, with our insight. We see that in phase two, the sensitive, the emotional aspect evolves and the insight aspect involves. In this second phase, as an immigrant, we construct a sense of familiarity in the surroundings where we have arrived. We try to realize our need for contact and security. Our insight in the connection of all people all over the world gets a limited expression in this phase. We build ties of sympathy with a limited circle of people. In the third development round of the planet, all beings develop their vital qualities. They are more and more capable to be active in the outer realms, to become active themselves. To be able to become active requires intellect to steer and direct the actions. These two qualities form a pair, and when our vitality dominates, our intellect loses its leading role. You recognize it at yourself. You have to act without knowing why and how. In short, in this period, the vital aspect evolves and the intellectual aspect involves. In this phase, we as an immigrant start playing an active role in the community. We have a profession, or we actively contribute in another way. Often it is necessary in the beginning to really make an effort to put a lot of energy in. But also here, there is this connection with our intellect. If we react to every possibility to become active without thinking, we create ourselves an overvital and chaotic life.
In the fourth development round, all beings develop their desire. And what, in fact, is desire? It is the ability to realize a goal that you see before you. Desire is a neutral force. We need that force to accomplish things. And desire has two sides. One is directed to the spiritual and one to the material. The fourth phase is always the middle phase, that is to say, the period of choice. It's the turning point, the most material phase. And now we must choose. Do we keep on directing ourselves to the outer nature and material desires? Or do we see through its limitations? And do we direct our desires towards higher, nobler goals? In this fourth period, desire evolves and involves. And by that we mean, if it is right, we evolve our spiritual desires and we involve our material desires. We make these subordinate. We learn to control them and we give them their proper place in our lives. And that's the challenge of this fourth developing round. It is the most critical period. And also we in our new country go through this critical period. We are settled. We are well off. And now we have to make a choice. Are we satisfied with this? And do we devote the rest of our life to securing our wealth? Or do we make a fundamental step to realize our higher thoughts? For example, do we also want to make an essential intellectual or spiritual contribution to the new country in which we live? We can compare this phase very well with what we often call a midlife crisis. Also, the core of the matter is the question that what would you do with the second half of your life? You understand that this overview of the seven phases we present gives a very general image, an average pattern of development. There can be always behind and ahead. Of course, there are immigrants who are focused on their higher ideals from the moment they set foot in their new country. We do not have to wait until we are settled, but although the settling will normally take up a lot of energy and attention. Our planet is now in its fourth phase, round of development. Now we human beings have to deal with the choice what desires we want to pursue. We can go through the next three phases if we choose for our nobler ideals and aspirations. But although we human beings on average are in the fourth round of development, there are already humans who are one round further, or even in rare cases, two rounds. Every cycle offers chances for development, and we ourselves determine the pace. In the fifth round of development, all beings develop their intellectual qualities. And at the same time, they learn to control their vitality better and better. The intellectual aspect evolves, and the vital aspect involves. As an immigrant, we have built up so much knowledge now that intellectually we can contribute to the community by suggesting and implementing improvements. Now we are also ready for a management position.
In the sixth round of development, all beings develop their abilities of insight, sense of community and vision.
Doorzien zij de illusies die onze zintuigen oproepen. En dat is in feite al een zeer spirituele.
This is already a very spiritual phase. They see through what senses, their senses. In other words, the perceptual aspect is evolving and the emotional aspect is involving. We as an immigrant now have developed inner wisdom. And the people in our community spontaneously start to ask us advice because they notice that we have a vision of the causes of problems and are capable to solve these in a harmonious way. We won't let ourselves be misled by impressions anymore. The colors don't blind the eye anymore. The sounds don't deafen our ears anymore. We see through outer appearances. And in the seventh, the final, the closing round of development, the planetary beings give expression to unity. the unity that always existed, but of which they were not completely conscious. At the same time, they see through the illusion of matter that gives us the impression that bodies would be unconnected, isolated. Also, they draw up the balance of what they have done in the cycle that is closing. In this last closing period, the aspect of unity evolves and the material aspect involves. This seventh phase is concluded and reaches its highest point through the controlling of the outer bodies and the return of the consciousnesses of all beings in the cosmic source from which we came forth. After this seventh phase, the planet dies with all its collaborating beings. The planetary rest period that follows lasts as long as the embodied period. So again, 4,320,000,000 years. After that, all beings will be ready again for the start of a new planetary cycle, and every being, if it is right, in a higher kingdom. In the meantime, we have in our new country developed a universal compassionate vision. This enables us to inspire our fellow men, to lift them up above egotism and group interest. In this closing phase, we look back at our emigration and we draw our ethical lessons. Our thinking has become so universal that in fact we have overcome our attachment to our new country. Now we can make a new step. And if we stay, we will do it because we choose to, because we think that here we have our inspiring task. Now let's oversee the whole process of growth. Do the beings of all kingdoms go through these seven phases? Yes, this is the case for all kingdoms, says the Theosophia, but all on their own level. An animal being unfolds the seven qualities on his animal level, and the human being on his human level, and so forth. To give an example, while we humans beings unfold our intellect, plants and animals will train their instinctive intelligence. We all know that animals and plants act effectively, and sometimes even show a remarkable cleverness. And even the mineral beings have some sort of intelligence at their limited level. When we have unfolded all seven principles of consciousness in harmony and control, and control these, we have become perfect in our kingdom. Those who, for one or another reason, in this lifespan of the planet did not achieve that point of perfection and thus cannot finish his learning class will have another chance in the next life period of Earth. You become as a student that has to do the same class again. But the special aspect is that in this future cycle you will be a front runner in your kingdom. You will be the front runner because you already partly learned the lessons that the big wave of beings still have to learn.
Now we bring all thoughts together. So what is our place as human beings in the cosmic cycles of waking and sleeping, as the title of this lecture says? Our planet, this giant alliance of beings, is as said in its fourth round of development, in which the emphasis is on the unfolding of our force of desire. We just passed the big turning point. Of course, we are in the fifth planetary class of the fourth round. That is, at the moment we are developing the intellectual aspect of desire. The average man has just started the ascending arc, and that's still a matter of struggling, as we experience daily. If we choose to follow our higher insights, then a grand field of human evolution lays before us. But on the ascending arc, not a single being can progress on its own. All beings can be considered as the cells or organs of the organism Earth, and our function as human being and as humanity is to pass on the wisdom of the higher developed beings to all who are less far developed than we are. This concerns our fellow men, but it also concerns all beings that follow us on this laborious path of growth, the animals, the plants, and so forth. We human beings are the links in a stream of consciousness that flows forth from the spiritual heart of the earth, and from there flows through all beings, or should flow through all beings, to give all beings the chance to develop what they are entitled to. How this ascending arc looks like, given our present society, and what we can contribute to it, will be the subject of the next speaker, Jos. But now, your questions. I wonder, we are now in 4-5. And there is a certain time involved to be able to go on, to continue. Can't it go faster? The question is, can't we go a little bit faster with our inner growth? Well, you know, we really are in charge ourselves, because that's our experience. Maybe as a youngster you have ideals when you start your life, and it is up to you whether you let it go, more or less, let's say, or if you try to shape that continuously. But as theosophists, we're very optimistic, but we also say, and that will be talked about in later lectures, growth means something. When it's about changing your habits and letting go of your desires, attachments, so you can talk about it, but every inner step is not something that you do just like that, and certainly not just intellectually. And that means that everybody who tried to break through one habit in his life and build up another one, everyone of you who tried this knows that even breaking through this one habit can be quite difficult. Imagine that we are busy when we focus our thoughts on a day as today, on this future round, and which can be an inspiration for us, then in real life it starts with implementing the ideas. Imagine in theosophy not much emphasis is placed on the question, how fast do we go? We have this tendency, have we progressed today? But from theosophy, from compassion, do what you can, do the best you can, and do not keep on asking yourself where you are. What is the use of that?
I hope this answers your question. So I hope that Henk will repeat something of it.
Thank you.
Herman says it can go faster. It's not physical growth, but mental growth. I already said in the introduction, if we succeed to give you what we prepared, then I can say that you will do a step today and tomorrow. Next question, please. In the start, you were talking about the descending arc. Can you explain it again? I don't understand about the arc. It involves the waking up of the planetary being, the first birth phase. You have to imagine that this rest phase between two lives is on a very spiritual level, very involved on a spiritual level. And there they have their deep rest. This waking up, this being born, is from in to outwards, from the very spiritual level, and to build up a body, and to descend a complete being is all levels together, spiritual, intellectual, and finally a body, a material part. It's in the end of the birth phase. A very, very slow process from spiritual to material, building up of bodies. And this focal point, you can compare this in the small with the human soul that is prepared to be born and is on the in the phase to build up a physical body. And this mental, this human soul makes contact with a I with the XL and this cell, thanks to the human soul that works behind it, that is this cell is the focal point, the first cell on the material realm. If you have this focal point, then it starts attracting all other beings, and that means the baby is going to build up its body, and this body is built up of many, many cells, and all these cells are beings themselves, and all these beings help to let this body function very good. And these beings are being attracted through this magnetic field on a very structural in a very structural way, and they are born and they are a part of our body. So you can imagine this.
Ik snap de fases die je doorgaat. Mijn gevoel is dat heel logisch. Maar het ontstaan van het planetenwezen, dan wordt gesproken over 7 bollen. En van heel, ook weer heel etherisch naar stoffelijk en weer omhoog. Maar moet ik me dat echt voorstellen als 7 verschillende bollen in ruimte en tijd? Of ja, is het toch overlap?
Ja,
daar gaan we. Ja, goede vraag.
Good question.
Ja, weet u, het is, wij zijn altijd de sleutel bij de theosofie.
We always say that in theosophy the key is the analogy. In the big, it is also in the small. When you get more familiar with theosophy, you can also read a lot about how the composition of man is, and we already have a divine part that is active and a spiritual part that is active, and the same composition from divine to physical is the same for a planetary being. And we know that the planetary being forms on every sphere a concentric globe. But what do we see of it? With our senses, we only see the most material globe. If we would have the quality to focus on the higher globes, then you would really see a similar globe as we have here with beings on it, and you would know that there is also something that you could call matter, and you could call a humanity. Everything is there, but on a different level, a slightly different level of consciousness. So it is the analogy with here, with us. But maybe humanity there is a bit smarter, they learn faster maybe, so it's all varieties on the same theme. So theosophy gives us the image that the cosmos is built up from all kinds of worlds, different characteristics, but in their core they work together. Yeah.
Dat wordt dan.
Ja, ik wilde wat vragen over het stukje wat u vertelde over de natuurrijken die de planeet Aarde bezielen. En de eerste daarvan die u noemde was de drie bovenmenselijke rijken. En ik wil vragen of u daar misschien iets over kunt zeggen.
Pas nog geweest, hè?
Ja, de drie bovenmenselijke rijken.
The three superhuman kingdoms. That was what the question was about. Whatever name they have. You can imagine that our evolution as a human doesn't stop when you are a perfect human being, a Buddha, that is not the ending. And Gautama the Buddha said it himself, it's not the end to it. Then you have these superhuman kingdoms, and then you get a lot of times you get a question, so how does this superhuman kingdom look like then? And what do you do then? There's a difficulty there. With our human consciousness, we can only have a very restricted image of the divine consciousness. And what we can do, we can have an ideal life, a Buddha life. That's what you can do on your human level. With your deepest qualities, you can do that. And you have to gain more, even more insight. These beings, these divine beings, do have so much wisdom that they can have. Yeah, the divine kingdom is a service kingdom. And they, with their own free, all these beings, all these human beings, with their own free will, they, all these, and as a god, you try, within the cooperation in nature, you try to lead these human beings without coming to the free will of human beings, because you always have free will.
Maar als ik denk, u noemt het drie, dat er bijvoorbeeld sferen zijn, zoals bijvoorbeeld de zon, de zonnen, stelsels, niet één maar velen, hebben sferen en galactisch, stelsels, die hebben ook sferen. En de samenhang van bepaalde delen hebben ook sferen. Dus ik probeer een klein beetje een tipje zo van, ja, het is werkelijk fantastisch wat u allemaal vertelt. En ik probeer ook een stukje context te zien wat voor horizon is daar dan? Hoe zou ik dat enigszins kunnen begrijpen? Maar, ja.
Ik denk dat, misschien mag ik het even gezien de tijd even heel kort afdoen.
Herman wants to make a short answer. You're totally right. It's a very complex image of all kind of realms that are interlinked. But the core thought is in the fact that the power that is
it is about being influenced and influencing. So there are two forces, and we will come back to this. But that gives a very intensive image of how it all works. So maybe we leave it at this. Later we have a workshop, so there you can ask some questions also, and we go to the next speaker.
Bedankt.